Do you remember your last supper before the pandemic hit? Do you remember the last meal that you had out in a restaurant with friends? The last meal before fear and anxiety ran the conversations we were having? If you had known it was your last, would you have lingered? Would you have ordered dessert? Would you have held your friends' hands and told them how much you loved them? If you had known, would you have washed their feet?
We remember this night, which for Jesus was the beginning of the end. This night we hear again of a love that knows no bounds. The love of Jesus, who is gathered at the table with his friends, sharing the bread of life and the cup of blessing. We might imagine that they lingered, but we also remember that most of them did not know what was ahead.
So let us remember Jesus, who tenderly served those in the room with him and commanded us to love. Let us tonight contemplate the temptations of the world which entice us, like Judas, to betray the trust of God. May we be fully present in this moment as we worship God. May we be held together. Jesus said to the crowd who searched high and low for him after he had fed 5,000 plus people in partnership with a young boy who had 5 barley loaves and 2 fish to share, "The bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." And they were hungry. They were hungry for more. They had once tasted of this miraculous bread on a hillside in Galilee. It fed their body and it fed their soul, and they wanted more. Well, Jesus redirected their search, that instead they should look for the bread of God coming down from heaven, which would give life to the world.
We come to this holy day also searching for peace, for meaning, for healing, for hope, for the bread of God which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world.
On Thursday, in this great and holy week, Christians feel called to the table, perhaps more than any other time of the year. Of course, this is because we retell the story, combine the gospel narratives, and contemplate all the moments we have heard of which led to the cross. When we offer the great Thanksgiving and come to the Lord's Supper, we always tell the story of this precious last night that Jesus shared with his closest followers.
For some, it's been a year or more since they have found their way to the table of the Lord. The virus restrictions have kept us from one another in so many ways. A crippling disease has silently crept into all of our lives. Maybe what's crept into our lives isn't only a coronavirus. On this night, perhaps more than others, we must think of our own betrayals, our own short-sightedness, our own struggles to trust in God and care for our neighbor.
Yes. It has been a complex, ambiguous, challenging, and sad time. We now are called to prepare for the bread of God which comes down from heaven and into our lives. Just as Jesus prepared to observe the festival of the Passover with his disciples, he is also at work to prepare our hearts to receive the promise of new life. So we wrestle with our sadness, with our impatience, with our fears, and with our own betrayals of the Son of God. Jesus is the bread of life. May we eat of this holy truth and live with the God who comes down from heaven to give life to the world. Amen.
A reading from St. Mark, the 14th chapter. Hear the word of the Lord. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, his disciples said to him, "Where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?" So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there." So the disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he came with the 12. And when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." They began to be distressed and to say to him one after another, "Surely not I." He said to them, "It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the bowl with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to the one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born."
Surely I would never betray you, never deny you. Surely, beloved, give me the faith to doubt my righteousness. Give me the assurance to question, to examine myself honestly, to ask. Give me the confidence to wonder how I might betray your perfect love, to see. Give me grace to confess how my promises are broken, my heart broken. Give me the peace to be troubled by my smugness and repent. Open my eyes to see that you see, you know, and even knowing, you keep right on eating with me. Amen.
A reading from St. John, the 13th chapter. Hear the word of the Lord. Now, before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example that you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them."
Jesus said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you?" This didn't happen in an instant, in the twinkling of an eye. The life of Jesus had changed them. Following Jesus didn't take away their faults, their foibles, their fears. We are reminded of that every time we hear a cock crow or fall asleep rather than stay alert to the request of another, or struggle to avoid suffering with others, then we see ourselves in good company with the friends of Jesus.
But over time, weeks, months of adventures, and parables, and teachings, and prayer, the disciples learned day by day to be more like Jesus. That happens to us too. It's not a straight line trajectory, that's certain, but we are shaped and molded by living in Christian community. That's what Jesus has done to them.
There was only one night in which our Lord Jesus was betrayed that led to the cross. The Gospel of John does not mention his commandment to celebrate a meal. Rather, John focuses on a new mandate that Jesus lays upon those who knew him and followed him. You ought to wash one another's feet.
We receive the gospel when we take Jesus as our Lord and teacher. Now he sets an example for us. This is what he has done to them, to us. Reshape the meaning of our lives to be in service to one another.
If we're feeling drained, burdened, frightened, hopeless, we'll be blessed when we find a basin, fill it with water, and repair the dusty, calloused feet of another. Sometimes I miss those opportunities. Last week, a young man came into the church on a damp, windy day, and he was not aggressive, but he was agitated, and I was a bit frightened. He asked for shoes. He was only wearing socks and hospital slippers, and his shirt was almost paper-like, one bright color. He asked for shoes. I didn't have what he needed. I offered him food, but he didn't accept that. He asked for shoes, and he didn't stay long. Now, looking back, it dawned on me later that perhaps he had walked away from treatment at Methodist Hospital, which is just down the street a bit. Why didn't I ask his name, offer to make a phone call, invite him to prayer? I didn't have any shoes. Again and again, I am aware of my limitations.
Serving will stretch us. We cannot always know what is right. We must accept that sometimes we fail, and we are forgiven, blessed with new opportunities. Messengers are not greater than the one who sent them. Servants are not greater than their master. But we do become more like Jesus with each desire to serve, no matter how incomplete our efforts.
This day, as we think of Jesus sitting with his disciples, getting up from the table, and kneeling to wash their feet, this day, we contemplate our desires to evade suffering, to take the easier path, to avert our eyes from the needs of another. The love of Christ redeems. Jesus washes our ugly feet. Amen. God, who holds us together.
If I were to place myself at your table, I would probably be Peter, misunderstanding your radical hospitality, sticking to the rules, arguing what I do and don't deserve.
And it's possible that I'd be Judas, the one who betrayed you, the one who failed to see the good right in front of him, the one who might have thought he wasn't worthy of your love.
If I were to place myself at your table, it's possible I would have been one of the unnamed disciples, watching but not speaking, silently missing the opportunity to tell you what I believe and how much I love you. Holy God, if we were to place ourselves at your table, we would have made the same mistakes made by the well-intentioned disciples. There is no surprise there. What is surprising is to know that you would have washed our feet too. Forgive us, God. Wash my feet, my hands, and my head also. Amen.
Jesus knew that Peter would deny. He knew that Judas would betray, and he knew the disciples would hide in fear. And still, he invited them in. He washed their feet and he fed them. What does our Lord Jesus know about us? My friends, we worship the living Christ whose love shocks, surprises, and far exceeds our understanding of love. So let us remind one another that no matter who we are, no matter where we go, no matter how great our mistakes or regrets are in life, we are invited in and held together by the living God again and again. Amen.
Reading from St. John, the 13th chapter. Hear the word of the Lord. Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another."
Bold disciple Peter shrunk back from having Jesus wash his feet. "You will never wash my feet," he said. Jesus responded, "If I don't wash your feet, what share will you have with me?" So a physical foot washing is not possible for us this year. We decided it's too soon to linger in close proximity to one another, risking virus transmissions. But honestly, I have always shied away from this tactile, symbolic experience because my feet are ugly, uneven toenails, rigid calluses. I'll wash your feet, but I don't want you to touch mine.
Jesus says it's a two-way street, though. Sometimes we have to practice receiving care, to feel the touch of another, to humbly accept a sign of grace.
I suspect many others share this challenge with me. The artist, Liesl Gwen Garrity, tells this story about what inspired her visual reflection on Jesus' new commandment for his disciples.
"The first time my dad took me to visit her in the hospital, I walked in to find a slouched figure below a bundle of blankets, short brown hairs collected in clumps along her shoulders and pillowcase. A cotton beanie grasped the edges of her yellowing, swollen face. I averted my eyes at the sight, tricked by cancer's devouring disguise. Pale walls drained the room of energy. Even the blue curtains in the window drooped lethargically against the wall. As we came close, my mother's shrunken torso grew. Her familiar, honey-rich voice filled like liquid in my ears. Take off your shoes. Let me rub your feet. I paused. Death pressed in on us like unrelenting fog. I was scared, unsure of how to play daughter to a mother whose life was slowly slipping away. Let me rub your feet. Reluctantly, I climbed up onto the hospital bed. Reaching through the blanketed layers, she removed my shoes, the sweat from my middle school basketball practice still lingering on my skin. Without hesitation, she peeled off my socks and gently massaged away the anxieties building within the room. In the face of the cancer that would soon take her, my mother was determined to hold us close. In the fading and fullness of life, she savored moments of service to others. Her gentleness continues to startle and soothe me.
Jesus said, "You too must wash each other's feet." John doesn't mention if on that night, Peter or one of the others took the basin and washed the feet of Jesus. I hope so. As disciples of Jesus, on this holy day, we reflect on a myriad of ways we find to serve our neighbors in need and to receive the care that God provides for us through the love of others. What a privilege. What a healing balm in our weary world. Amen.
Came to the world you created, trading your crown for a cross. You willingly died, your innocent life paid the cost. And counting your status as nothing, the King of all kings came to serve. Washing my feet, covering me with your love. If more of you means less of me, take everything. Yes, all of you is all I need, take everything.
Take everything. If more of you means less.
Let us pray. Blessed are you, Lord God. The basin and the towel are signs to us of your Son's servanthood. You have made us one body in Christ and servants of one another. Give us grace to count others more important than ourselves, to love our enemies, to make peace. Send the Spirit of truth to keep alive in us what Jesus taught and did, that our words may carry his good news, and that our lives may bear the shape of the cross of the one who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Noun, a small open container, sometimes having a handle, used chiefly as a receptacle from which to drink.
What does your favorite coffee cup say on it?
Number one, Grandma.
Campbell's soup.
Liquid power.
Stressed, blessed, and coffee obsessed.
Or maybe it just says Starbucks.
Maybe you believe that coffee is constant proof that God loves us and wants us to be happy.
And whatever kind of cup it's in, you know what to expect when you take that first sip.
A latte with whipped cream and a caramel drizzle.
Chai with extra shot of vanilla.
Or just plain old truck stop coffee with a cream and two sugars.
You ordered it, or you poured it yourself, but it's exactly what you wanted.
But what if it wasn't?
What if you dropped a sugar cube in your cup only to discover it was full of beef broth?
What if you took that first sip from the cup and tasted gasoline?
What if you took a big swig and got a mouthful of Elmer's glue?
Not pleasant to think about it, but isn't that life?
We find our cup is seemingly filled with bitter experiences.
Your cup runneth over surely, but not with things you want.
So we drink, but we are dismayed at the taste.
Our Heavenly Father has wisdom to know what we need to grow, to mature, to become more like him.
We don't always like the flavor.
Even Jesus asked that he not have to drink from this cup if there was any other way to accomplish the goal.
But he so loved the world that he gave his life.
Jesus drank the cup of God's judgment so that we would not have to.
That's how great his affections for us are.
He allows our cups to be filled with many things. Many are sweet and delicately flavored.
Laughter and beauty and quiet moments with family and friends. Drink those deeply. Savor them.
But do not be afraid to drink from the cup of suffering.
Be strong. Be courageous.
When your cup is full of pain and sorrow and loss,
drink deeply of them as well, knowing that God will take them and build you from the inside out.
And as you drink, look over the brim and see the grace in his eyes.
Let the flavor, sweet or bitter, fill you.
Close your eyes and think of what was in the cup Jesus drank.
Think of his sacrifice.
Drink and remember.
Sit here while I pray. The sorrow in my heart is so great, it almost crushes me. Stay here and keep watch with me.
Stay with me.
Father, I have shown your glory here on earth. I have finished the work you gave me. I have given my disciples your message, and the world, it hated them. Yet I don't pray that they may be taken out of the world. I pray that they may be kept from evil. Sleeping Peter, can you not even keep awake for an hour?
Stay with me, remain here with me, watch and pray, watch and pray.
Father, I pray not only for my friends, but for all that believe their words. I pray that they may be one, just as you and I are one. Father, the world does not know you, but I know you and they know you, so that the world may believe that you sent me. May they be one. May they be one. Peter, keep watch and pray. Don't be drawn into temptation. The spirit is willing, but oh, the flesh is weak.
Stay with me.
Father, if it is possible, take away this cup of suffering from me, but let it not be what I want. Let it be what you want. Are you still sleeping? Are you still taking your ease? The hour has come for the Son of Man to be handed over to sinful people. Get up. Let us go. Look, here comes the one who is to betray me.
A reading from John, the 18th chapter. Hear the word of the Lord. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers together with police from the chief priests and the Pharisees, and they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" They answered, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus replied, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you are looking for me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me?" So the soldiers, their officer, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus and bound him.
We are each a tapestry of stories. We live a story of fear and grief, as well as a story of love and joy. We believe that God sees all of these interwoven truths and says to our fragile selves, "Come in. Come in from the cold, come in from the rain, come in from wherever you are and share in my story."
God pours warm water into a basin to wash off the weariness of the day, the bruises of the past, and the doubt that clings to us. This is an act of love. God says to us, "Eat," and it is food not only for our bodies, but for our souls. May we know that the parts of our tapestry which feel worn and frayed are held together. Tonight, as we remember and give thanks, may we each know that we are held together again and again. Amen.